Barbara Boxer's office told us to watch the Thomas signature, or the bill collection next week, which means that probably her office has signed on to the Senate bill. That's what they told us when we handed them the Ed Asner letter, which was actually written for Boxer and Maxine Waters. Now, I want to talk a little bit about this question of recruitment, how you do what Lynn is talking about in terms of this subjective intervention. And I'm going to put off this question of the Promethean principle to next week, but I am going to talk a little bit about the principle of chorus and this idea of how you get people outside of what they think is reality. Because if you think about the picture that Steve just went through, you know, let's really be honest and put this out on the table to start with. How many of you actually think that there will be a vote on Glass-Steagall in the next week in the Congress? Well, you could say you're pragmatists and that Lynn would denounce you for that. You could say you're realists. Or you could say that you're trapped in a false sense of reality. And there's probably an element of all three of those. You know, that the question of how you transform the situation, how you transform people, you've got to have a sense of confidence that that's something that you can do. That to get a bill through a Congress which is largely corrupted, immoral, has demonstrated from January the 3rd till today no quality of survival. Now, there are a few people who have said a few things. You see a few things move a little bit. We've moved a tremendous amount. I'm not pessimistic about what we've done. We've been creating miracles. But they still voted. There were still 217 votes with Obama, the Democratic leadership and the Republican leadership, to allow an illegal spying operation. Now, Holder and Clapper and General Alexander and others say, well, it's not illegal because we passed a law which enabled us to do it. Well, Hitler passed a lot of laws too that enabled him to do what he did. And this is where the question of the Nuremberg Code comes in. So this question that Lynn's been talking about a lot, about forecasting, about how you change the future, how you get an idea yourself about change. Because look, chances are, everything being what they are, even with a great mobilization by us, there's a good chance we won't have a Glass-Steagall bill by next week. Now, does that mean Lynn's wrong? No, what Lynn said is if we don't get a Glass-Steagall bill, your survival is questionable. Because anything can happen this next month, including a war danger, which is a real danger. And I just wrote a column for the European Alert called The Banks of August, where I went through what's going on with the banks right now. Why is JP Morgan doing these things with these commodity derivatives? I mean, yeah, because they can make money, sure. But why are they doing that? Why do you have these bankruptcies coming up right now? The Detroit bankruptcy, the possibility of a Chicago bankruptcy. Why is all this happening? Because the banks need liquidity. They need whatever they can get, whether it's quantitative easing or quantitative stealing. They need their hands on cash. They're illiquid and insolvent. Now, in a sense, they're not illiquid because a lot of them have a lot of cash. But they are insolvent because that cash is backing up huge piles of obligation, which dwarf the amount of actual liquidity they have, even with the Fed pumping it, the ECB pumping it, the Bank of England pumping it, and so on. So the banks are desperate. They're sending in the equivalent of Wall Street hitmen in the congressional offices. And in one hand, they have a bag of money. And who knows, on the other hand, they may have NSA tapes. You don't think that's real? Look at Anthony Weiner. Don't look too closely. Don't tweet him. Don't get on his Twitter list. But look at this guy. I mean, here's a guy, he's a contentious New York liberal. You know, he's got all the things that you like and dislike about New York liberals. He's a big mouth, he's cocky, he's arrogant, but he fights for the little people, he fights against Wall Street, and he also likes to flop his penis in front of a camera and tweet it off to people. Now, why did he get caught? Not only once, but twice. You know, he got caught initially, eventually resigned from Congress. Then he decided, this is a lot of bullshit, I'm going to run again. And he's running for mayor of New York. He shoots to the top of the polls. And then it comes out in the New York Post, which is Murdoch, which is the general spy operation in Great Britain, that there's a woman who's in love with him and thinks these pictures of his genitals that he's sending to her by Twitter are a sign of his genuine affection for her. And they actually got the Twitter communication of him describing sex with her. Now, he's never even seen this person. Except, I guess she tweeted a picture once. Who knows what she tweeted him? But what do you think this is about? Well, Wiener happens to be he's lumped together with Elliot Spitzer.
Right.
Someone else who was caught in a sex scandal. How do you catch people in sex scandals? You follow them. Most of these guys have sex scandals because they're not moral. So here's Spitzer running for comptroller in New York City where he could really do something. And they're trying to link him with Wiener. And now you have, who knows what's going to happen? Wiener may still win. New York is a funny place. I'm serious.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't drop that much in the polls. People want to see the pictures. But, you know, here you have this crazy situation. So who knows when a Wall Street lobbyist goes into a congressional office, may not be money they have in the bag, it may be tapes, maybe Twitter feeds, it may be emails. And so you've got this blackmail operation, you've got this money operation, and then, look, some of these guys don't have to be blackmailed. Some of them are just idiots who have been miseducated to actually believe in monetarist theory. Some of them really believe government is too big. And you can read them the Constitution all you want. Scott Garrett can quote by memory most of the Constitution. He just doesn't know what he's quoting. It's like a monkey that can know symbols to punch to get a banana. That's not exactly cognition or knowledge. But some of these people actually believe this stuff. Now, in the case of people like Greenspan, I don't know what he really believes. I couldn't tell you. Greenspan is someone who may have really thought it was not a bubble, although the indications are that he knew it was a bubble. He was trying to convince himself it was not a bubble. And the housing, I mean, look, Greenspan created three of the biggest bubbles in world history. He thinks bubbles are prosperity. And only when they pop, he says, until they pop, you don't know if they're real or not. So whether he believes that or not, I don't know. But you have these guys argue for austerity. You have the IMF admit that they were wrong in their policies toward Greece, and then they say, what's the solution? More austerity. So you begin to wonder, where is the sanity? And so you see this picture that's emerging. You have Jürgen Stark, who I had a chance to talk to at some length a couple of years ago at Alpbach, a conference in Austria. And he was saying, the thing I agree with, this is after I did an intervention there, he said, the thing I really agree with you on is that there really is something called the real economy. Because I said, to listen to the speeches here, except for Stark, you would think there's no such thing as a real economy. That derivatives are real indications of wealth. You're talking as though having a huge amount of unfunded liabilities in a bank is good. And Stark said, this is something I agree with you on. And 2 weeks after this conference, he resigned from his position as head of the European Central, chief economist of the European Central Bank. Not because he talked to me. He was already completely disappointed. And he said the other day, this thing could blow. You have Thomas Honig in his testimony. Honig, what is his job right now? He's vice chairman of the FDIC. So what does that mean he's looking at every single day? What happens with banks as they blow up? What do you do in a bank resolution? Now, this is, I'm going to go through this because this is something you need to know. It's actually quite simple. Most of this stuff is simple. They just make it seem difficult so everyone thinks you have to be a genius to be an economist. Like Larry Summers is the most disgusting person on the planet, but they say he's disgusting, but he's a genius because no one really knows what he's thinking. Now, what bank resolution is simple. You have a run on the bank because people don't believe the bank has enough money to meet their deposits, to meet their to cover checks, to cover corporate accounts and things of that sort. So people start cashing in. You have essentially a margin call. And at that point, the FDIC steps in, shuts down the bank on a Friday, send their accountants in. They count up the money in the vault, not really, but they're going through the books to see what are real assets. Now, what's a real asset of a bank? You know, assets are not the money the bank gets from the depositors. That's a liability, because the banks have to pay that back. But if a bank has loans to companies that are producing, then those loans do represent assets, because that's a company that will pay that back the loan. But you look at this thing, and what you find is that they've been loaning money back and forth to hedge funds, investment funds, to buy and sell worthless financial instruments. So they have all these worthless financial instruments, and then they've got their depositors' income, they've got a certain amount of money that's invested on their own accounts, and you look at it and you have to figure out by Monday, how do we reopen this bank? First of all, how much does the government have to step in to guarantee to cover now the $250,000, which is supposedly guaranteed? That, by the way, is not a hard and fast law. That could change overnight. That $250,000 guarantee would revert back to the $100,000, and that is not even a hard and fast law either. People who think they have guarantees have no guarantees. Especially that's true with what we've seen with the bail-ins. So you look at this, and the bank resolution is you look and see how much is needed. Now, with the First Bank of Oshkosh, it's pretty easy to figure out. With a local savings bank or a local credit union or something like that, it's pretty easy to find out. With these giant holding companies, there's no way to find it out, because you can't figure out over a weekend what a derivative is really worth. Mm-hmm. A derivative may have a $100 million face value. If you started selling off components of the derivative, what would you get? In some cases, you get nothing, because some of the mortgage-backed securities have no mortgage or house underneath it. It's a promise for a promise for a promise against which money was loaned. So what Thomas Honig said is that there's no, and this is what Dodd-Frank actually said, it's very difficult to do a bank resolution with these too-big-to-fail banks. So what Dodd-Frank does is say, well, you can use the assets of your depositors toward your regulatory capital. Now, what Honig said is that while that might work for one bank, you're not going to just have one of the too big to fail banks go, because they're so interrelated. They have so much interrelated paper. Bank of America has JP Morgan Chase denominated paper, and so on. So what Honig said is that you can't have a bank resolution if the whole thing blows. And that's what we're looking at. That's what we're sitting on. If one of these banks goes, it could trigger a systemic collapse. And then there's, at that point, when the money is called in, what do they have? They got nothing. They have your deposits, the bail-in. So we're facing that kind of situation that could happen in August when the Congress is on recess. And if that happens, there will be people who will die. You know, there is an increased death rate right now. People are killing themselves at greater levels. Here's just another case today in Florida. A gunman killed six people in an apartment building in Florida, and then the police killed him. That was, in a sense, a suicide, a desperate guy who couldn't cover his rent. And when the landlords came up to talk to him about it, he shot him. And once he killed them, he figured he might as well kill a lot of people. And luckily, the police killed him before he killed a couple more. That's a suicide, a murder-suicide, really. How many of those are happening every week? How many people are drinking themselves to death, killing themselves with drugs, just sitting there killing themselves by doing nothing but eating potato chips and watching television? That's a form of suicide. People isolate themselves. They have no friends. They have nothing to say, nothing to talk about. Their wife dies, and boom, they're gone. Their husband runs off with his golf buddy, and the wife goes out and kills somebody. Now, we're dealing with a situation where there's a social breakdown on top of an economic breakdown. Now, how many people know that? Many people know it in terms of their own lives. They know someone whose family has fallen apart. People in their church, they've taken in. Or people that are living in the churches. Their kids come home after college with no money, huge debts, and no future. Boomers have to take in their parents because their parents are living longer but have already used up all their disposable income. So people see this, but they say, well, I can survive. I can figure out a way to survive. And sometimes the way to survive is what kills them, because they drink, they do drugs, they do things like that. Or they just pull in their horns and say, well, I'll use austerity. We won't buy food. We'll only buy half the medicine we need, because we can't afford the whole medication. And in some cases, taking half the medication is more dangerous than not taking it at all. So you have this kind of process underway. People know it. Now, do the members of the Congress know it? I'm not sure. I'm not sure members of the Congress know how desperate the population is. But this is something we have to bring to them. As we bring Glass-Steagall, we're saying to them, this is not just about changing a banking law. This is about changing the economy. Not just about changing the economy, changing the nature of the American people from consumers, from people who live on borrowed credit, people who have dreams that will never be realized, or if they're realized, the dreams kill them. You know, they buy a house they can't afford and end up on the street, or a car they can't afford and end up on the street. So we've got to get this into the Congress. If we do that, and if this picture of reality gets through, and if this idea that there's a mobilization of people out there doing something about it, then it's possible we could get Glass-Steagall or force the Congress to stay longer to take it up. Once it gets on the floor, if we can get it before a committee, if Maxine Waters, for example, and this is something we should do here, if Maxine Waters will go to her finance committee and say, we're putting Glass-Steagall on the table, it would be interesting. Because then the question would be, how many of you who oppose this have gotten $100,000 or more from Wall Street? And that's where this question of the PCORA Commission and looking into who's been bought. And what you'll find is there are people in the Congress who are, if there's enough pressure, they'll basically say, well, I took their money, but I'm not voting for them. That happens. In fact, we should advise it. Take the money, but vote against it. Vote for your district. So this could happen. Now, how do you get to the point, though, where you have confidence that something can be done which you can logically show cannot be done? Because I can give you the 37 reasons why we won't get Glass-Steagall. You guys probably have your own 37 reasons, or 57, like the Heinz varieties or something. On the other hand, all those reasons may be true, but you still could get it. Now, how do you get that kind of confidence, the way Lynn does? I mean, first of all, it comes from being truthful. You recognize the obstacles, and you figure out how to flank the obstacles. But the second thing is, this is where science and culture comes in. You're not trapped in a dead culture. You're not trapped in a dead body or a dead mind. You know, a person who can't come up with new options doesn't have a creative process going. You know, this is what happens when you're organizing sometimes. And you just talk to 12 Granada Hills Republicans in a row. And you start thinking the whole human race is brainless. Now, a lot of times squads will pack up and leave and say, no one here can think. Isn't it true? You see the same thing, a phone team organizer, all of a sudden their spreadsheet turns into a bunch of rats. Lynn used to talk about this. Rats, rats, rats there, rats there, they're all rats. You see their whiskers wiggle, their nose, their beady eyes and pointy ears, they're all rats. They're all human beings. Some of them are miserable. Some of them are miserable being austerity-driven, Rush Limbaugh quoting nuts. They have no ideas. You know, the whole idea of Rush Limbaugh has a ditto heads. People call it a ditto Rush. You know, in other words, they have no mind of their own. They just agree with what he says. And so, you think people really are happy being a ditto head? Which is what Limbaugh calls them. You think people are happy that they haven't had an independent thought in 30 years? They just do what everyone thinks they should do? Don't you think some of these people are ready to break out? How do you get them to break out? And this is where Lynn is unique as a political organizer. She said you don't get them to break out by telling them all the bad things the banks are doing. All that does is make them cynical. Convinces them that you can't change it. If they can get away with all this, how are you going to change it? So an elaboration of facts, so-called facts, never works to organize. And for those of us who've been at this for 40 years, and sometimes you see it in Phil and me, we get a little frustrated because we say, don't go with the facts, go with ideas. And then what do you hear? Fact, 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 fact. Or as Lynn would say, turd, 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 turd. You want to come in with toilet paper. Say to people, there's a bidet down the street. Go down there, clean yourself up, and then get back in here, and let's see if we can come up with some ideas. So it's this question of the flank that comes from the ability to forecast. And you know, in the discussion of Prometheus, what you're talking about is Aeschylus forecasting the emergence of a Greek Republic by giving people an understanding of the history of their people and how that history has given them a possibility to create something totally new, a republic, overcoming oligarchism. And I'll go through that next Saturday night, and I want this room overflowing. I want our members to have to sit out in the hall or on the stairs. You know, we'll poke a little hole in the wall here or something. Do a closed circuit television. But we've got to start bringing people to these meetings and have these meetings function as forecasting sessions. So you free someone from their belief and sense certainty so they can begin to realize that there's a whole world out there of possibilities that's never crossed their mind maybe in their life or in 30 or 40 years, or if they're 20 years old, then 20 years. You know, you've got to get people connected to this idea that reality is not fixed. It's not linear. It's not shaped just by experience. Now, I just want to bring in this case, Lynn's discussion of the chorus in Shakespeare. Because people still don't get it. You know, people read it and they say, oh, this is cool. He uses the word imaginary 12 times in the chorus. He's saying, let this be in your imagination. I see what Lynn's saying. Well, that's the simple level. Because who goes to the theater and sees someone and thinks it's actually the King of England? I mean, people know that going in. I don't think the King of England ever played the King of England. You know, Obama plays the president. But you know, this is not how drama works. You know that there's something that's not real on the stage. So if that's all chorus we're doing, is saying to you, here I am, a crooked little figure in the corner of a stage, and on this stage, imagine the vasty fields of France. Two great kingdoms, horses pawing at the ground, mighty armies prepared for battle. Well, you know that that's not there. I mean, in Hollywood, the Kenneth Branagh version of Henry V tried to do that. They did get thousands of horses and extras and made a crappy movie. But what is Shakespeare's deeper point? He's dealing with a population that was in need of a kick in the ass. Henry V was his last history play. He'd written a whole series of these plays on the Plantagenets. He'd also written Henry VI, Part 1, 2, and 3. So anyone who was a serious theater goer already knew that Henry V was a bum, because it's exposed in the opening of Henry VI. The problem is, for most people in England, Henry V was a hero. He took small numbers of troops, fought against superior forces in Agincourt, and beat them because he inspired them. And that is what we Englishmen aspire to. We can take France. We can beat the Spanish. We can do whatever we have to do. We can extend our domain. And they're not thinking about what was it that Henry V actually did. He destroyed England. And so Chorus is saying to you, what you think is not real. What's in your minds is not real. And he gives a little hint, because in the opening he says that we see events of many years compressed in a time glass or an hourglass, meaning that you can understand the past and the future in this hour or two of this play. And you can become a part of changing. And so the very opening is not what most people marvel at and get all excited about. It's not simply that you have to use your imagination. It's that there's something wrong with what everyone believes. And that's why we're about to lose what was good about the Tudors who overcame the Plantagenets. Because when Shakespeare was writing it, Shakespeare couldn't write a play that said the oligarchy's corrupt and you need a republic. He would have been killed. Marlowe sort of was killed for that. But he had to use his powers with language to create for people an understanding that the future is something that they have to act on. And so you have the very opening of the play. How many have people read Henry V in the recent period? Any of you? What's the first scene? What's going on? Bunch of corrupt church leaders sitting around talking about how do we manipulate this bum to not tax us. That's what happens. They're talking about the fact that there's about to be a tax on the churches. And how about instead, if we convince the king we'd support him in a war against France and even give him money, less than the taxes would be. And in the meantime, while he's out fighting the war, we'll have less pressure on us. This is George W. Bush. This is Obama. The behind-the-scenes players, the churchmen and the nobility, organizing war. There's a whole discussion in there which makes no sense about, well, do we really want to leave the border with Scotland unguarded? Don't we have to keep troops back? So they're basically saying we're going to go to war, but with not enough troops to win, so we can continue to fight the battle over who's going to rule inside England and get this bum Henry out of there. Now, there's another scene. You know, people always say, what's all this thing with Bardolph, Pistol, and Quickly, and the bums that were friends of Henry V when he was still Prince Hal? And what you see is the conditions of the people of England. They were degenerate. They were a bunch of rogues and thieves and drunkards and whoremongers. And Henry as a youth was one of them. Now he's supposedly this great hero. But who's his army? these guys all enlist and go to France with them. And some say, well, as Henry grew up, he realized he had to control these guys, so he had to threaten to hang them if they did things bad in France. But chorus, you've got to keep coming back to chorus. The beginning of Act Two, what does chorus say? Remember, it opens, "Oh, for a muse of fire," which may be a reference to Prometheus, who knows. So what is the opening sentence of the second act with chorus? "The youth of England are on fire." For what? For war. So much so that they sold the pasture to buy a horse. Now what a beautiful metaphor. You know, you might say, well, they're selling their home front to buy a horse to go to war. What does a horse used to eat? Pasture land. What happened? This is basically saying they gave up on the future for the great glories of war. And so on. And you, as you go through the play, yes, the speech at Agincourt is quite moving. The idea that we few, we brave few, we band of brothers, we will fight. And years from now on St. Crispin's Day, everyone will say they were there, but we'll still have the scars. We'll be the ones who can say we did it. And they go out and they fight and they beat the French. The French were a mess. The French had no competent government then. The king was a bum. The Dauphin was a coward. But you had a young woman, Joan of Arc, who is to emerge to be the leader of the French army shortly after this play. And so you go through the great victory, the battle is won, and then what happens? Well, in the very end, when chorus comes back on, and everyone should be stirred with the triumph of the English and the great rhetoric of Henry and the inspiration of Henry, chorus basically says, well, those of you who already saw Henry VI know what's coming up. But he says, read it. And he says what you get then at the beginning of the Henry VI, where people are standing around the dead body of Henry V. He's dead. That's a young man still. And they're comparing him almost to Jesus. Oh, if he could be resurrected for a moment. You know, it's really hilarious to read the beginning of Henry VI because they're lamenting his death and we need him to rise up now. And then what happens? A messenger from France shows up and they say, what news have you? And he says, not good news. We lost France. Our leader Talbot has been captured. And one of these nobles says, by what treason is this? And the messenger says, not treason, but want of arms and men. They ground up the population, they went broke, they sold the pasture for the horse got killed, and now they have nothing. Not only that, but they have a new king who's less than a year and a half old. And all these squabbling bastard noblemen fighting over who's going to control the kingdom. So what Shakespeare does with Henry V is throws out the most profound challenge possible to people who then have to take that idea of what was bad with the Plantagenets and figure out what to do with the coming death of Queen Elizabeth and no clear succession for England and not a very good policy for England. And that during Shakespeare's life, you had the beginning of the battle of the Venetians to take over England, which really took a century. An ongoing battle, which wasn't won until William of Orange came in. Now, that's the kind of drama. You know, as Helga said in opening the conference in San Francisco, would that we had a Schiller or a Shakespeare to look at our current times and give us an understanding of what we're facing. Now, we are the Schillers and the Shakespeares. You are. Those of you who are young may even write something someday. You never know. But you have to take these ideas of that Lynn is introducing on creativity and the nature of the mind and the ability to overcome the traps of sense certainty and to develop the real imagination not the imagination that sees a screen with people moving and thinks that's reality. I mean, if that's the case, as some people do, we're in real trouble. But the deeper question, are there ideas that are capable of introducing change in the situation? Is there something we can do that can move the Congress this week beyond business as usual? Is there something we can do to take people who we're talking to understand the profundity of this situation and get them to move on it? Can each of us find 15 people who can be mobilized Monday and Tuesday to generate a tsunami effect on Maxine Waters so Maxine wakes up Tuesday night or Wednesday morning and says, shit, I've got to push Glass-Steagall through this week? Can we do that? Can you do that? And that's what Lynn is saying we have to do. No business as usual. No coming up with some clever strategy. But finding ways from within you that you can move someone else to get a sense of the potential that we have as human beings to overcome even the most serious kinds of problems. And this is a serious problem, danger of nuclear war and complete financial blowout. That's a serious problem. Mass starvation, that's a serious problem. Development and spread of new diseases, these are all things that we have to take as our responsibility to stop. So I think that's my point on recruitment, that you have to think of yourself as a Shakespeare or a Schiller or a Mozart or an Einstein. I mean, you think Einstein had it easy going in to organize at Solvay? When he knew that there were huge amounts of money and grants and tenured positions being offered to hacks to oppose what he was presenting. What do you fight with? Fight with truth. So that's what we have to do. That's the question that Lynn is posing, especially in the Kepler, Shakespeare, and Kuza paper recently, you know, of how we access this higher level of creativity as an organizing tool. And realize it's not just an organizing tool, that's what it means to be human. Human beings are organizers. You know, at the beginning of Prometheus is talking about what he did for man, and one of the things he said is that before he brought fire down from the gods, people didn't even know to build a house to get out of the sun. They lived under rocks and in tunnels. He organized people to set up a whole woodcraft industry and a building industry to look at the stars so they could figure out the season so they could plant, to figure out how to use animals to pull, to use muscle power of animals so that human beings didn't have to do it. That's how society and civilization got built. That was an organizing process. You know, somebody had to say, why the hell are we pushing these square rocks when we can break them and curve them and get these damn animals to do some work? That'll never happen. The animals don't want to do it. Their union won't let them. So the development of civilization is an organizing process where people did things that hadn't been done before. So can we get Glass-Steagall through? Let's see. Let's give it our best, not just, you know, staying up every day, 24 hours, the next 7 days, but give it your best. Don't accept the idea that we can't do it, because if we don't do it, the best we're going to have is an uncertain possibility of survival. Lynn is not playing games when he talks about the guns of August. Now, we've talked about it before, and we didn't have nuclear war. Why was that? Well, maybe it's because we talked about it. We went out and told people, this is what these guys are planning. You know, after we brought up this thing about the air-sea battle, you see people like Paul Craig Roberts digging up the reports that say that, oh, don't worry, we can provoke the Chinese to the point they'll realize they have to back down. These guys are crazy. So that's our responsibility, to provide that higher quality of human intervention. And you know, hopefully we'll get enough people mobilized so that, you know, we'll have a victory party next Saturday night. We'll have a lot of people here to hear about Prometheus.
There
you go. So that's pretty much what I wanted to cover. See if you have some questions.
Yeah, I know when like people are pessimistic, you try to break that, it's like very difficult.
Well, how do you convince someone who's pessimistic not to be pessimistic? You say, well, look at the bright side. You know, my mother, God love her, is a real optimist. You know, at 91 years old, she's still planning on getting up and running sometime soon. You know, she goes out and does her physical therapy every day. And you know, she's the kind who says, well, look at the bright side. Things aren't as bad as they seem. That doesn't work. The reason people are pessimistic is because they have been trained to think in a way that gives them no alternative. And you've got to provoke them to think in a different way. You know, I may have mentioned this. I think I did earlier. I don't know if I mentioned it. I may have even mentioned it tonight. So if I'm repeating myself, it's just because I'm getting old. But, you know, on this radio show I did today, there's a very interesting thing that came up, which is the guy who is a Ron Paul libertarian who's come a long way towards supporting, he supports Glass-Steagall, he supports a credit policy, he's trying to work to get Ron Paul and the libertarian movement, not Ron Paul, but the supporters of Ron Paul, to join the Glass-Steagall thing. But he has his old axioms. So what he said on the show today, well, I completely agree with what LaRouche and LaRouche Pack and you and Bill Roberts are saying about Detroit. Although I don't want to get into the question of why it got to this situation, because we don't really need to talk about unions and pensions, but they were too big, and this is, but you know, what's being done is wrong. And I said, well, wait a second. And that's when I brought up this question of, isn't it interesting that people don't bring up the trillions of dollars that have been given in bailouts to the banks, but they complain about a $20,000 pension to a retired teacher. Which is bankrupting the economy? The bailout of the banks or paying a teacher a barely living retirement? And you know, you've got to crack the axiom to get people to see that their thinking is wrong. Now in some cases you just have to say, what a pile of bullshit. You couldn't possibly believe that unless you were told that by some complete idiot. You know, you do have to figure out, but you can't make someone optimistic by saying, oh no, here's the scenario. First we get 10 more signers, then we get 20 more signers, then the Washington Post will endorse it, and then Obama will quit, and then everyone will come out and vote for Glass-Steagall. That's what Lynn said. You used that quote at the beginning of your briefing. If you're looking for a formula, forget it. And, you know, here's the real interesting thing. Oftentimes, the best way to respond to these things is spontaneous.
Mm-hmm.
You get an insight because you realize you're talking to a person. You're not talking to a stick figure. That they're a real person. And that maybe they will respond if they're insulted. Maybe they'll respond if you challenge them. But you have to find a way to get them to respond. You know, I was thinking about this question at the end of the San Francisco event. Is there one right way to recite a poem or play a piece of music? And I remember something Beltran once said, because this question came up in some of the old acting things we were doing. And Robert said that the most important thing to do as an actor is to listen. You listen to what the other people are doing. You don't just listen to where they stop and then you start. Because a lot of people, that's how they act, by cues. Okay, as soon as they say this, then I come in with my law. Well, what happens if the other person suddenly has an insight and says their line differently, emphasizes a different concept, has a change in the music of the way they present it? You just can't go back with the same answer that you had. When you're organizing, it's the same thing. There's no right answer to someone who says, oh, you'll never get it. There are 30 right answers, but none of them are really right, because it depends on what you've already learned about that person, the quality of dialogue you've started with them, and your spontaneous intuitive insight into what will move them. So the main thing you have to know is someone who's pessimistic is a victim. You can even say that. You're a real victim, aren't you? I really feel bad for you. You know, it's like the joke about the difference between an optimist and a pessimist. You take each of them and you put them in a pile of horse shit. And the pessimist just looks at the horse shit and sits down and says, what am I supposed to do? The optimist is digging away and digging away. And you come in and say, what are you doing? He says, all this horse shit, there's got to be a horse around here somewhere. So what you're dealing with is a quality of the mind that's not evident to the person you're talking to. They're not aware of how victimized they are by the way they think. This is where charity or love comes in. You know, it's not that you go out and say, I love you, man. I wish you had my But you express that love by trying to free them from their victimization. You give it a shot. If it doesn't work, you move on. You know, some people are committed to being victims. There's a whole television cable station, Lifetime movie channel, which is about all the victimized people you'd ever want to meet. And it's a popular channel. You know, it's the 37 different varieties of cancer death channel. You know, you want a tragedy? The tragedy is we're all going to die. Is that a tragedy? You know, Prometheus, one of the things Prometheus did is he took away from man the knowledge of when they were going to die. Because the mythology is that up to that point, just like animals know when they're sick and they go off into a corner to die, that human beings would know when they're going to die, and that would be the end. And Prometheus said he took that foreknowledge away from them. And the chorus says, and what medicine did you give them in its place? And he said, I gave them blind hope. The idea that I'm going to keep fighting. I'm never going to surrender. I'm never going to give in to death. I'm never going to give in to anything. Blind hope. And out of blind hope, you create a civilization. So that's the Promethean principle. That's a little bit of a teaser for next week. But, you know, don't be surprised by people being pessimistic. Everything they see induces them to be pessimistic. Being a New York Mets fan, you know. or Chicago Cubs fan.
Hey, 1969 proved that wrong.
See, Gerald's the kid who found the horse. Anything else?
They were called the Miracle Mets.
I like what David Ben-Gurion said. He was asked, do you believe in miracles? And he said, any Israeli who doesn't believe in miracles is not a realist.
That's not a realist.
All right. Good. Decent week this week, but yes. We have to have a better week next week.
Right. Good.
Thank you.